Today, there are many applications and systems which actually rely on the recommendation system. I think if you think about social networks like Facebook, for instance, just tell you who you should be friend with, what you need to look at. You know, Netflix, the entire interface is about recommendation. Well, obviously, you know, websites, music websites, or streaming websites, or e-commerce websites. Everything is driven by recommendation systems, which actually help to filter out what is the most relevant content that you're likely to buy or watch or do.
This is Anne-Marie Kermarrec, the Director of Research at INRIA, Rennes. She is also a scientific collaborator of the IC School at EPFL, as well as founder and CEO of Mediego, a startup that provides systems for real-time online content personalization.
Basically, the idea is that a recommendation system basically take all the data that it can put its hand on about users. So that could be past history, navigation, browsing history, that could be buying history. Also, many other things can be taken into account, like, you know, how many content you share, you know, with others, what you liked and everything. And then based on this, there are some decisions. So the idea is that based on what you did in the past or other did in the past, then the algorithm can actually make some prediction of what you're most likely to do in the future.
So this is the general principle. Tell us what you liked and we will tell you what you will like.
The most basic things is probably what we have with aggregator of opinions. So things like TripAdvisor, for instance. So in that case, it's a recommendation system, but not that personalized in the sense that the opinion that matters is actually the one of the most influential people or the most popular items, for instance.
Now, that's cool, but it's only like Web 2.0. These days, Silicon Valley companies are using much more sophisticated recommendation systems.
There is an entire class of personalized recommendation system. So in that case, you can have some explicit content-based things. So, for instance, say you like, movie which are like labeled with science fiction and stuff like this. Then whenever there is a new movie coming out, what you try to do is that to see to what extent the content or the metadata of this movie match your interests that you had in the past.
But the really hot kind of recommendation systems is still more clever.
There are other systems which are very popular right now, which are the collaborative filtering systems. So the idea is that not only you take your history into account, but also the one of the others, and you leverage this, the other's experience to actually, help the recommendation system to predict what you are going to like. So say that, you know, we look alike and we like the same things, then, you know, it's very likely that what you are going to like in the future, that you liked and I don't know about, I'm going to like in the future.
Collaborative filtering is typically Netflix's recommendation system, as we discussed it in a previous video. So how does collaborative filtering work?
The way it works is that you can imagine that you have a matrix, okay, and you have the rows are the users, okay, and the columns are representing the items. So say it's movie, okay. Then on a user profile would be there would be some of the cells of the matrix filled with, a rating, okay? And this is a very sparse matrix, okay, obviously, because users usually watch a very little proportion of the item. And the challenge for a recommendation algorithm is to try to fill the empty cells, okay, with some score that reflects how much a user is likely to like that given movie, okay? Now, the way you can do this is to the most common way to do this, for instance, is to try to compute for each user which are the most similar users, okay? That's one kind of algorithms. And once you have this, so first of all, you need to compute the similarity between all pairs of users, Okay. And then you, the weight of a user in the ranking for one cell will be dependent on that weight. Okay. So say that we are very similar, then your opinion about a movie will matter a lot to me. If we are not similar at all, your opinion will just, you know, almost be not taken into account. Okay, and this is how the scoring is computed. Now, with respect to similarity, one very common way, for instance, is to decide how close some users are. You can imagine, like, you have a multidimensional space of which is number of dimensions is obviously the number of items. And imagine that you have a vector, which are the profile of two users. One common way to compute the similarity between users is to compute the angle between the profile. Okay? That gives you how similar users are. And then you take this into account into computing the entire score, and you put your score in your matrix. And then you recommend the one that has the highest score. So that's one way to do it. Now, so this is one class of algorithm, and then there is an other class which is, matrix factorization algorithms, and then the idea is to reduce the dimension of the problem, because obviously you have a large number of items and large number of users, and to restrict the users and the item according to a few dimensions which are automatically extracted. And this is also very popular, especially when it comes to applications such as movie or books or syntaxes, where the interest over time do not change that much. So, you can have this computation done and then provide a recommendation quickly.
In a previous video with Martin Jaggi, we discussed how a similar matrix factorization allows to model words as vectors as well, in quite a similar manner as the way it models users and movies as vectors.
So usually in the recommendation algorithm, there are two things. This is, what is the amount of work that you have to deal with, you know, offline or as much as you can? And then when a user needs a recommendation, how quickly you can provide the recommendation. Okay. And the algorithms which I use really depends on how quickly you can do these kind of things. And this really depends on the application. So for instance, when you are designing a recommendation system for, you know, say, a streaming video system, then your interests are not very likely to change overnight. Okay. If you like this kind of movies, you're still gonna like it in the day. So the challenges here are, you know, to provide some precision and be responsive enough. But this is not the same as when you're on a media system where basically, you know, the items are very short term. And also your interest might change. Okay. You might be interested in some kind of news at one moment, and then next week you don't care about it at all. So in that case, you need much more real time. And this, obviously, given the amount of data and the amount of users, then scalability is a very important issue.
And people use exactly the same mathematical model to find good recommendations for movies or products, like say on Amazon, than the model we've described here.
One of the danger, and we've seen this, in, for instance, in Facebook, is that if you keep talking with people who look like you, okay, or getting recommendations from people who look like you, you are going to be, to look the same, to look similar more and more, okay? And obviously you're going to, you know, stay in your bubble, what is called bubble of interest.